الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We'll have this reminder until Maghrib Salah. And just before I came, I was switched onto the Saudi channel where they announced officially that Monday will be the first day of Ramadan and that first Tarawih will be tomorrow. Inshallah, unless some Bedouin sights the moon right now. That was the official one that they announced several times just before I left from the actual Saudi channel itself. So hopefully we will start our Ramadan from tomorrow after Maghrib, bi-idhnillah. The topic here is about Ramadan, this month that is here. A very blessed month, a month where Allah has given it the highest of all privileges over all the other months. Allah has blessed this month by revealing the Quran inside it. And it was the first revelation that came down. The first part of the Quran that came to the surface of this earth was in this month of Ramadan. The first time Allah has contacted this ummah was in this month of Ramadan. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has given us this Quran as the biggest miracle that of any prophet. It's the greatest miracle any prophet would have ever bought. It's been given to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And out of all his miracles, this is the greatest miracle. The Quran itself. Because all his miracles had certain time limits. When he split the moon, it has certain time limits and so on. But this miracle, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made until the day of judgment. And the miracle, subhanahu, what is the miracle? There are so many miracles of the Quran. One great miracle is that you recite the Quran, Surah Fatiha. Tell me, if you got a count of how many times you read the chapter of Surah Fatiha, has anyone got a count? Has anyone got a count? Yes or no? No, you haven't got a count. Why? Because it's endless. Each reciter recites Surah Fatiha with a different tune or with the same tune even. Some of them. Over and over again. Can any believer say with faith in his heart that he has become bored of the Quran? Can any believer say that? That they have become bored of the Quran? A song comes in the charts, hits number one. How long is it going to last? How long? It's not going to last. Just a few weeks. Months at the most. Then people get bored of it. It's out of the charts. People used to listen to it once a day, twice a day. Then people start listening to it once or twice a week, then once or twice a month. And then after a while, once or twice a year. But they're not going to visit it as much. And when they get older, maybe once in a decade, they listen to that song. But the Quran, subhanAllah, you listen to it and, you know, as many recitations you listen to of the Quran, one with belief and faith will never say that they become bored of the Quran. Allah opened the verses about Ramadan and He says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. This is the month in which the Quran was revealed. And why was the Quran revealed? The Quran was revealed for straight away after Allah says, هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ, that it may guide people. My brothers, are there any sisters listening to this at home? There are? Okay. And my sisters who are listening. The Quran's guidance is what we want. There's a very big link with the huda Allah has mentioned, the guidance, and between the people of that guidance. The people of that guidance are some people. That guidance itself is our objective. How do we get that guidance? Allah said, وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ. You can get not only guidance, you can get many different clarifications of my guidance, many different signs of my guidance. You can get many different parts of my guidance, but I'll give you in the end Furqan. You come closer and closer to me, I'll give you Furqan. Furqan means that you yourself will be able to differentiate between truth and falsehood, between sin, between good acts. You yourself will get to the stage where you will not need others to guide you, you will guide yourself, because you will be my close one. What is that? Allah said, begin the Quran, Hudan lil muttaqin. Those people are the people of taqwa. The people get guidance of the Quran. Quran has been revealed in Ramadan. That Quran, Allah said, is your guidance, it's your goal to get that guidance. But to get that guidance, you need to be the people of taqwa. Allah said in the beginning of the Quran, Hudan lil muttaqin. Those people of taqwa, those people who are taqwa. Now, what is taqwa? A person says, what is taqwa? Allah explains. Allah says, the people of taqwa are those people who have these qualities. First is that their beliefs, of all their beliefs they have, we have many beliefs. We have belief right now that Canada exists. We have beliefs right now that in my house, you know, I've got this there, I've got that there, I own this, I've got this bank balance. We have these beliefs. And we have a belief about the unseen world. I have a belief about all this seen world, what I see. And we have a belief about the unseen world. Allah says that the people of taqwa put first their belief of the unseen over the belief of the seen. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Those people who believe in the unseen. Why did Allah mention that? Because of course you have beliefs about the seen life. Everyone believes you're here right now, you're seeing these walls and so on, you're in the masjid of Clapton. You've got this belief. But Allah says, Allah didn't say الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ with something else. He said بِالْغَيْبِ. They believe in the unseen, things they haven't seen. I've revealed it to them. I've said I exist, they believe in that. I've said my malaika, that they believe in that. I've said my messengers came, they believe in that. I said that the Quran, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave to them, they believe in that. This is ghaib. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the ghaib now. We never saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We never saw the Quran being revealed, but we believe in it. We believe in the akhirah. Allah said there will be a day of judgment. You will be resurrected. We believe in that. Allah said, I will give you jaza and I will give you reward. They believe in that. Allah said, there is jahannam. They believe and they fear me for that. That is taqwa. That is the essence of the people of muttaqin. And not because of that, what do they do? Yuqimuna salah. A person who has these beliefs inside him, who has them inside him, he has to, by default, he has to establish prayers. He has to be concerned. The biggest concern in his seen life, after his unseen beliefs, is that he must stand in front of Allah. He's standing in front of Allah, subhanAllah. It's got a very big connection with Ramadan. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ قَامَ رَمَضَانَ إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ. Whoever will stand in front of Allah, whoever with that iman, with the belief of the unseen, will stand in front of Allah. Whoever with iman and belief inside him, and knowing that Allah will reward him, ihtisaba, Allah will reward him. Just stand in front of Allah in salah. Whatever salah that is, whether it's taraweeh, whether it's qiyamul layl, whether you will go to tahajjud, whether it's 20 rakats behind the imam, taraweeh, or later on you go home and you do your qiyamul layl, whatever it is, this is what? This is standing in front of Allah. مَنْ قَامَ رَمَضَانَ إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا. Whoever will stand in front of Allah in the month of Ramadan with two things, with the belief inside his heart, with seeking reward from Allah. غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِ. Allah will forgive all of his past sins. Allah will forgive all of his past sins. Allah loves the fact that I haven't seen him. You haven't seen him, but my iman inside him is there, just to show that iman. What is that iman? That iman is, oh Allah, I haven't seen you, but I found hadith, and that hadith said to stand in front of you, and I'm now standing in front of you, oh Allah. Allah loves that. That is what iman is. That is iman. I know brothers come to me a lot of the time and say, iman, I've got waswasa. I've got things in my heart, and subhanAllah, if you look at the ahadith, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'een, they being living with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, staying in his majlis, seeing him directly, they came to him with the same questions. A lot of brothers come to me. Imam, some doubts, sometimes they come. I can't even talk about it. The same way the Sahaba put it. They said, Messenger of Allah, Najid fi anfusina. We have things in our hearts that we find. لَأَنْ يَحْتَرِقْ They say, لَأَنْ نَحْتَرِقْ حَتَّى نَكُونَ حَمَمًا They said that, if I could burn till I become like black coal, that or coal that is just left as ashes, if I could become that, it's better that I become that than to express the different thoughts I have of Allah coming to my heart. These are what some Sahaba said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't ask, in any of the narrations, he never asked, what are these thoughts you have? He never asked that. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, wajadtumuhu, said, did you really find these thoughts in your heart? They said, yes, we did. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam then asked, he said, did you find yourselves fighting against these thoughts in your hearts? Did you find yourselves fighting against these thoughts in your mind about these thoughts that have come and you're uneasy about them? You want to attack these thoughts. You want them out of your heart. They said, yes, Messenger of Allah. He said, tilka mahdul iman. This is a riwayah of Muslim. He said, that is the pure essence of your belief. The fact that you have fought, the fact that your mind is restless with these thoughts coming into your mind, that is iman. That is pure iman, he said. Pure mahdul iman means proper iman without any other mixing inside it. It's absolute pure organic iman. He gave that saying to the Sahaba, and he didn't just give it to the Sahaba, he gave it to us. Now my brothers, if we find waswasa coming into our hearts about Allah, about the existence of Allah, about the fact why are we doing these things, about the fact, you know, people have different things. What will happen if we wake up in the grave? What am I going to see? What about if some of this is not totally true? And these things, these are waswasa from the shaitan. They will come. They will come because we are mu'mineen. He will try and attack us with this. But to stand firm and to fight this and to stay firm and say, no, I believe in it. This is pure iman. And that's what Allah wants to see. Standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the month of Ramadan in the night time. That is an absolute shahada and witness of a person's belief. And that was a hadith of Bukhari. Another hadith of Bukhari, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever will fast during the month of Ramadan with two things inside them, two things you need. If you fast the month of Ramadan, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that all your past sins are forgiven. One is iman, belief. I believe Allah exists. Allah has told me to fast and I am fasting for that Allah. That's it. That's belief. And the second part, which is I am fasting so that I can gain reward from Allah. I will find my reward on the day of judgment with that niyyah. That inshallah one day I will have my reward. These are the two things which are there for a person who wants all their sins forgiven. So in the daytime during Ramadan, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that your fast, if you have these two things inside you, your fast is enough to forgive all your sins. In the night time by standing, and what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, standing, he's left it, in Arabic they call it mutlaq. Mutlaq means it's open. Whenever it's left open, the more you do, the better it is. There's no restriction to how long you can stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And brothers and sisters, it is better for us to stand more than to stand less. The argument of the Taraweeh, whether it should be 20 or whether it should be 8 rakats, a simple solution to that, I will tell you, to the whole argument, is the reporter of that hadith about the 8 rakats, Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha, our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, And apparently, she says in the hadith that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam never prayed more than 11. 3 meaning witr, and 8 meaning his 8 rakats. Whether she says, whether in Ramadan or outside Ramadan. Whether in Ramadan or outside Ramadan, he never prayed more than 11. And then she says, don't ask me about the beauty and whatever and so on and so on. But she says in the hadith, he never prayed more than 11, meaning 8. Whatever it was, Qiyamul Layl, whatever you want to call it. So if it's outside Ramadan, you call it Qiyamul Layl or Tahajjud. And according to these scholars who, I would say, misunderstood this hadith, they have said that if it is inside Ramadan, then it has to be only 8 rakats. Because she says, in Ramadan or outside Ramadan. Now, our mother, Aisha radiallahu anha, was she an ordinary woman? Come on, guys, was she an ordinary woman? Anyone who studied Aisha radiallahu anha knows that she was not an ordinary woman. She would challenge anyone if she had to. She would sit in her hujra. And when great sahaba men would be quoting hadith in the masjid, they had her in the back of their minds. Because when they made a mistake in hadith, she would start to talk from behind the veil. She would say, Kadaba Abdullah. She would say, that person has made a mistake. Imagine you're a muhaddith, you're a person who's quoting Rasulullah, you're a sahabi, you're a man, and you quote hadith to several people like this. Suddenly a woman from behind the veil, Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, he's made a mistake. How dare he say this? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never meant this. He meant that. That's how strong our mother Aisha radiallahu anha was. Whether it's Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, whether Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, she was our mother. And she had that status. She was a single woman who narrated more than 2,000 ahadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you did not, first thing is you did not compete with her, unless you were like Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu in hadith quoting. But whether you knew more hadith than her was not the case. It was her that she had that challenge. Whether you liked her or not liked her, she would tell you. Now you tell me, my brothers, tell me this. To end this argument, because books have been written on this, and I don't see anything more than this argument that I'm going to put forward to you to end the debate. If it is the case that our mother, Aisha radiallahu anha, by this hadith she meant in Ramadan, if it's Ramadan, then 8 is just Taraweeh. And you can't do any more after that, that's it. 8, you've done, that's it. Rasulullah never did more than 8. And it is by the same hadith she meant outside Ramadan 8, which is Tahajjud al-Qiyamul Layl. Then, this mother of ours, she was in the masjid when Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu gathered the Muslims together and he started the 20 rakats. And according to him, that was the sunnah. No sahabi challenged Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anha. Even our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, who quotes this hadith, she lived the full 10 years of Sayyidina Umar's khilafah. And let's say for argument's sake, if she couldn't speak in front of Umar, she lived the full 12 years of Uthman radiallahu's khilafah, and not 1 year out of his 12 years when they had the 20 rakats going on in Masjid al-Nabawi, every single year did she ever speak out. And she lived through the time of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. And our mother, even though she got against a battle against Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, that's how much of a great mother she was to us. She had that authority. She did not ever quote. Why are you men going against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he never prayed more than 8. Tell me, brothers, is there anyone here who's got an argument against what I've just put forth to you? To say why? Why? If our mother, in several ahadith, she's challenged Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. She's challenged Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. She's challenged major sahaba on issues. And she said, you quoted this, I'm quoting this. You said this, I am telling you that's a wrong meaning. She's done this. It's in Ahadith, Bukhari, Muslim, you pick it up, you find it. So now the fact that from the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, it happened. This same, are you telling me, am I supposed to honestly pick up this Hadith? And the very woman that quotes it, she had a different understanding. She agreed to the 20 in that time. She agreed to it. She kept silent. Completely silent. She agreed to the 20. Then what's the meaning of this Hadith? Then you must agree that the meaning of this Hadith was not talking at all about Taraweeh. It was talking about the common sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of his Qiyamul Layl, which is Tahajjud, which he prayed in Ramadan and outside Ramadan. And in Ramadan, his Taraweeh was separate to his Tahajjud. Have I made that clear to you, brothers? If there's anyone here who wants to challenge me, please ask me right now. Because I am waiting for one person to come to me and give me a good answer to this question that I put forward. There is no argument about from this hadith that we understand that Taraweeh is supposed to be 8. What are you trying to say, Ya Allah? You're trying to say that you cannot pray more than 8 rakats in Ramadan, in the nights of Ramadan? What are you trying to say? That the Prophet would never pray more than 8 in Ramadan? I can't understand this. I had a debate with one person once for 3.5 hours on this issue. And I said, every hadith we went through. And I said, in the end, because the thing is, if you follow what I'm trying to say, that this hadith is to do with Qiyamul Layl, it's a separate issue, it's got nothing to do with Taraweeh. Taraweeh is separate from this. If you believe that, everything is in harmony, all the different ahadith are in harmony. But if you go accord saying that this hadith is talking about Taraweeh being 8, then you have to tie so many knots in the other ahadith and give it so many different twists and turns to keep your own opinion correct. It just becomes a mess. It becomes a mess. My thing is, brothers and sisters, after this is, look, Taraweeh is sunnah, that's fine. But if you're going to pray it according to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the sunnah is definitely not 8. It's more than 8. Whatever the case is, there is definitely not 8. The hadith, the way this has been understood, is a great misunderstanding. And people have fallen into this where they, you know, people are looking. La ilaha illallah, people are looking. If you look at the mentality of the Sahaba and the mentality of the people of today. Today, you get a person come to an imam, and the imam will say, Imam sahab, I'm opening a new business. Can you please come and make dua? So you say, okay, what is your business? It's just a restaurant. Have you got any alcohol? Customers can bring it. Can you please come and make dua? Then we get some good blessing. So you think to yourself, I'm going to be, you know, is it allowed? Oh, Imam said, well, we've heard this. I mean, some scholars are saying this, and why can't it be? I mean, it's Darul Kufr and Darul, come on, friend. Right? This is their question. This is how people are approaching today. In the masjid, after fard prayers, people, when you try and tell them, read your sunan, read your nawafil, at least your sunan, read them, the sunnah prayers. But it's not fard, is it? It's not fard, is it? You don't have to pray, do you? Allow it, man, allow it. That is their attitude. This is the current attitude I'm talking about. You look in the Quran, Sahaba radiallahu anhu ajma'in, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْعِهِمَا. They come to you and they ask you, Messenger of Allah, we are Muslims, we have this pathway, we are the right people, why is it that we've got alcohol halal, why is it that we are gambling, why is it that these things are allowed in Islam? The question was, why are we doing this? This was in early Islam. So Allah said, there is some sin in this, there is some benefit. Later on, another revelation was revealed, and it said, at least don't come to the prayers while drinking. And later on, the final verse came. They were waiting, Sahaba were agitated, they were waiting, we wanted to become haram. This was the attitude, very clear in the hadith. And when the final verse came, to make it prohibited, Sayyiduna Umar radiallahu anhu expressed his happiness. He said, Al-An, Al-An. He said, that's it, that's it. That's what we were waiting for. This is their attitude. And here the guy said, allow it, Imam. Allow it. I mean, what's your charge, you know, for the dua? I'm talking about. In their time, you did the fara'id. They sat in their places. Sahaba said, we knew when the time of the, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has made the salam, because you know they had no miking system. They said, we knew that the salah was over by the amount of dhikr made after the fard prayers. You know the dhikr? Allahu Akbar, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, Allahu. You know the dhikr after the prayers that we do? Because of the amount of sahaba making that dhikr, it was so overwhelming that the people right at the back, who couldn't hear the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, knew that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has just finished his prayers. And then they would do the salam. They knew the prayer was over. That's how the dhikr was made. Then if you looked at the sunan, subhanallah, the sunan and the nawafil, Zainab radiallahu anha, once the Prophet ﷺ comes inside the masjid, between two pillars of the masjid, he comes, he walks in and he sees a rope tied from one pillar to another pillar. He said, ma hadha al-habl al-mamdood? He said, what is this rope that is stretched from one pillar to another pillar? And this is Sahih Hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sahaba, they said, Messenger of Allah, this is the rope of Zainab. She comes in the masjid, she prays extra nawafil, to the extent that she gets tired, and she's tied this rope so that she can hang onto the rope and not fall asleep. This woman is holding onto this rope, and she's tired, she'll drop on the ground, but she's holding herself with these ropes, and she's still trying to pray her salah. To that extent, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, take this rope down. When one of you gets tired, let him go to sleep. He's telling them, cut down. Guys, you're doing too much. Cut down. Not like, allow it, it's not fard, is it? We don't have to do it. I mean, come on, you know, just, what do we really have to do? I mean, the whole attitude is different. If you want to be serious, believe, if you want the nusra of Allah, the help of Allah, if you want the closeness of Allah, we've got Allah said in the Holy Quran, فَإِنْ آمَنُوا بِمِثْلِ مَا آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ فَقَدِ اهْتَدَوْا. Said, if you lot believe, to us he said, Allah said to every single generation, if you believe and become like the Sahaba, the way the Sahaba believed, as in, you try and follow their footsteps, then you're guided. They were guided, you will be guided. Our example should be in the example of the Sahaba, how they did things. Now, subhanallah, in that time, what do you find? The Taraweeh, when they prayed the Taraweeh, they prayed tarteel. Slowly, they prayed. Now, it's not a fard to finish your Quran in this Taraweeh. It's not a fard. What I would say, I know people might not agree with me, but in these short nights of Ramadan, when we're praying Isha about 10-something, 10:30, probably finishing at 12 o'clock, I would put my suggestion to the committee members here and to any other committee members of any of the masjid is to give people I'm not asking for a revolution here, okay? Guys, please, don't take my words and say, you know, Mulisabne Kedi, you know, they lie that, you know, they take you, the fatwas they want to use against somebody else, they'll use that, you know, say like, please, calm down, yeah? Just, this is a request. The request I'm giving to every masjid is, in these long days of Ramadan, the short nights of Ramadan, have two tarawis. Two different tarawis. In two separate places of the masjid. Where one is just short ayats. Portions of the Quran. Short portion, half a page, quarter page. Another one is the full Quran. Another one is the full Quran. Why? We'd rather see people do the full 20 and then get back to work the next day. You think about it. You've got 12 o'clock, you're going to go back home. You've only got 2 more hours till suhoor or something, 2.5 hours till suhoor. You've got to go to sleep, get up, have your suhoor, and go, you know, wait till fajr, pray your fajr, go to sleep, wake up early in the morning, go to work all the way till 5 o'clock in the evening, come, and it's all hot as well, hot summer. I mean, people, I believe we should give them a choice. At least they still pay the 20 rakats. Those 20 rakats will take you 30, 35, 40 minutes with Isha Witr. Whereas other people who've got the time, who've got the effort, who want to make it, give them a choice of full Quran. Let them. But the full Quran should be with tartib. I mean, I'm not talking about super slow. And I'm not talking about super fast either. Both. I mean, this ummah has been, Allah said, ummatan wasata. We are a middle nation. Meaning that we don't have extremes. To actually pray so slow that people's legs are aching. Yep. You know, come on guys. Yeah. I think that's too much. But to pray so fast also is a crime. It's a crime. Just to get the Quran finished, to dum 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 dum. And all of a sudden when there's a stretch, you just hear the stretch. And the guy, when it comes to a mud, he'll stretch it. When it comes to the end of a verse, he'll stretch it. But in the between, Allah knows what he's saying. I've been behind these imams and they do my head in. Seriously. Stanley, you can't even catch the mistakes. You just about catch one. By the time you caught the mistake, he's gone 3 hours ahead. That is not the Quran, mother. The Quran, Allah says when you reveal the Quran, tartila. Rattil al-Quran tartila. Recite the Quran in a steady manner. So the steady manner means, and it's more enjoyable. It's more enjoyable. You know, people, honestly speaking, people who are asking for that masjid, 1 hour 30 minutes, that one 1 hour 35, that one 1 hour 20, mashallah, alhamdulillah. And if you can get any shorter, then let's quickly make it there because, you know, we've got to get back home early. I mean, honestly speaking, let me put a question to you. People buy, you know, I'm not asking you to do this, but people do this on a regular basis, okay? They watch films. When have they ever asked? That film is 1 hour 20 minutes, that one 1 hour 5 minutes, that one 1 hour 15 minutes, I'm going to go for 1 hour 5. I can't watch the 1 hour 15, I can't watch the 1 hour 20. When have they said that? Tell me guys, when have they said that? It doesn't matter. I mean, when football comes, right? When it comes to World Cup, 90 minutes game, then if it goes into extra time, extra time, guys, extra time. More, more. Yeah? Then it goes into that some kind of golden goal or something. They're still watching it. No complaints. It's like, yeah, baskar, yara, baskar, baskar. Come on, get up, switch up. So none of that business. Then it goes in penalties. Then, penalties. Spend another 10 minutes just watching the players get together. You know, who's going to take it? This guy's going to sue first. That guy's going to sue next. By the time you've finished, you spent 2.5 hours to almost 3 hours. No complaints. Nothing. I mean, honestly, I say this openly. You got no complaint in those things. But when it comes to Imam, 5 minutes here, 2 minutes, a guy announced and his announcement took another 2 minutes. My God, give them a rest, man. They need to make the announcements as well. That needs to not come in the way. If a person enjoys the recitation, honestly, for the few people who want it to go fast, you give them a choice. Give them another separate part of the masjid. There's going to be tarawih over there, and it's going to be with just the surahs or just, you know, certain parts. Give them that choice, doesn't matter. But at least the people who do the full Quran should enjoy it slowly. Not too slow, okay, not too slow, but medium. Medium. And it's very beautiful to listen to the Quran in that tune. Very beautiful, and you enjoy it as well. And the barakah is in that as well. The barakah is not in reading it, you know, like Grand Prix. Try and get, you know, Formula One. Who's going to get the fastest to the ruku? And sometimes the rukus, you know, I'll be honest with you, the rukus and sujoods get so fast, yeah, they give you a backache. You get more tired, honestly speaking, you try this out. You get more tired in a quick ruku, up, quick sujood, 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 up again. You get more tired like that than to actually do it nice and steadily. You try it out. You get more tired out like that. So that shouldn't be the case. The whole essence of it is Allah said, I've revealed the Quran. This Quran is for our guidance. The guidance is for me to be a muttaqi, for me to have taqwa. I'm not going to have taqwa if my whole thing is to cut down on the Quran, cut down on taraweeh, cut down on the sunnah. That's not what Ramadan is about. And it's not just Ramadan, it shouldn't be outside Ramadan either. Not cutting the religion. Cut to, I've got just the bare bones of the religion left. That's not what religion is about. Religion is about spirituality. Religion is about getting closer to Allah. Religion is about increasing my own. Oh, you know, if you, honestly, tell me guys, who's done this? Who's prayed? Who's prayed a 2 rakats without having the concentration go away from Allahu Akbar to Assalamu Alaikum wa rahmatullah? Who's done that? Just put your hands up. In your life, at least once, you've done 2 rakats. 2 rakats. And if you can't put your hand up, I'm not asking you to do riyah here. But if you can't put your hand up, then there's a big question to this. What am I doing? Honestly, seriously, what am I doing? Why haven't I, at this age, if you're 30 sitting here, 25 sitting here, 30 something sitting here, 40, 50 sitting here, if you can't put your hand up, there's something seriously wrong. And if you can, those of you who can, put your hands up on, those of you who can, at least 2 rakats with full concentration. For some young children, you've done it once here. Did you do that fast or slow, tell me? Slow. Who'd you put their hands up here? Somebody put their hand up around there. I'm telling you, there's no one will tell you that they've done it fast, number one. Second is, did you enjoy it or did you not enjoy it? Did you feel calm or did you feel like you're in a rush? You felt calm. Anyone who's done this will tell you the serenity you get. It is better to offer 2 rakats to Allah, because Rasulullah said this in the Hadith of Bukhari. He said, "Man tawadda'a فَأَحْسَنَ وُضُوءَهُ." Whosoever does his wudu and he does a good, complete, perfect, excellent wudu. What does excellent wudu mean? To basically wash the hand properly 3 times. A lot of people don't do it, they just once. Just about slap the water, that's done. Not even do like that, just take the water straight down there. And then forget the masa, put in the 2 hands, just stick your hand inside there. I mean, that's, wudu is done. It's done. But if you want to do a proper wudu like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and you want to get the feeling of serenity, do it properly. Take your time. Washing your feet, do it 3 times. Wash your feet 3 times. The right foot once, then another whole time, then another whole time. Once somebody said to me, "You're taking too long for your wudu." You know, people wait for you in the wudu hana, yeah? People waiting behind you, queuing up. A guy says to you, you know, "Come on, hurry up." What hurry up? What hurry up? Cut the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You wait. You're in the queue, you wait. Let me finish this. I'm not talking about when there's moments where you really need to, a lot of people are waiting, like Hajj time or something like that. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about, you're trying to do your wudu properly. Then, I'm not talking about when the iqamah started, when, salah is finishing, and yet you're there, mashallah. By the time you finish that wudu, probably the imam has gone home. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about, you're there, you're doing your wudu, salah time is coming up. Right? You come up, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, then this person offers 2 rakats. And that 2 rakats is fa'ahsana. He says, he does it in an excellent manner. These words of the Prophet. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had once a person came inside Masjid, the Hadith of Bukhari. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw him and the person prayed quickly. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Salli fa innaka lam tusalli." Pray again, you haven't prayed. So the person prayed again, got up. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He prayed again. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was watching him, sitting there watching him. He said to him a second time, "Salli fa innaka lam tusalli." Pray, for you haven't prayed. A third time, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam then got up himself and he demonstrated for him. He said, when you go into ruku properly. There is a really good quality in this. I don't know if you've tried it. Try and get the back straight. Try and get the whole legs straight. To try and get the head in line with the back. To try and get into ruku with the arms locked, with the palms on the kneecaps, webbed hands, And to go in that position and feel so humble in front of Allah. You know, it's not like a person getting up and a person just, you know. No, a person gets in, the feet are towards the Kaaba, hands go all the way down. And then the person, you know, if you just do it like that, you're not going to have the straight back. What you have to do is right at the bottom of where your ankles are, that joint, you have to actually just bend that forward. You have to move forward where your pressure is on your toes. The pressure is actually on your toes. Yep. It hurts when you first do it. It'll hurt the back of your calves. It'll hurt, you know, it'll straighten, you'll feel. But after a while, you get used to it. When you've got your head in line and then to feel humble and then, you know, you stay there a good while. This is a big form of exercise. I'm telling you, a very good form of exercise. And then to get up. When you get up, to actually feel, and Rasulullah, what he used to do is, till all his limbs went back to its original position. This is in the hadith. Hatta yarja. Until every part of, you know, when you're standing up, if you just do it like that, you haven't waited. Rasulullah would go up and would wait till every part of his body, his hands, his arms, his elbows, his shoulders, have come back to their original place. Then he would go down into sujood. And when going to sujood again, to do that sujood, and to get into there, and to have the heart in your sujood, la ilaha illallah, there's nothing better than it. To get into sujood, to be close this position to Allah. Subhana rabbiyal a'la. Subhana rabbiyal a'la. Subhana rabbiyal a'la. Glorified is my Lord, you are the most high. Oh Allah, there's no fault in you, my Lord, who created me, who sustains me, you are the most high. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. Subhanallahi al-azim. To be in sujood, to talk to Allah, this is munajat. Munajat. No, munajat is, munajat is a man's secret conversation with Allah. This is the whole essence of salah. Rasulullah, when he would come up from sujood, he would sit down. Again it says, until every part of his body would turn back to its original place. So calm he would pray. And then, after making a couple of du'as, back into sujood again. And throwing one's whole heart into this person getting up in front of Allah. Why? What are we doing? I'm a beggar. I'm in front of Allah, my Malik, my King. He's my Khaliq. He's created me. He's my Malik. He owns me. He's what? My Basir. He sees me all the time. He's Samir. He hears me all the time. He's Razzaq. He's provided me. All the time he's provided me. In front of him, in front of Malikul Muluk, in front of the King of Kings, in front of the one who I call Wadud, the one who loves without a reason to love. In front of the one who is so affectionate to me, Latif, Latif, I am in front of him. In front of who? Sayyidi, Rasulullah used to say, Ya Sayyidi, Ya Thiqati, Ya Mawla, Ya Raja'i. Oh Allah, you are my leader. Sayyidi, my leader. Thiqati, you are the one who I put my full trust into. Ya Raja'i, you are the one who I have all my hope in. You are my hope. You are my hope. Raja'i. Mawlai, my master. Ya ahada man la ahada lah. Wa ya sanada man la sanada lah. In qata'a raja'u illa min. O one, who is the one for someone who has no one else? O one, who is the support for me, who has no other support? In qata'a raja, every single hope of mine has faded away except you. Except you. To say these words to Allah, to sit down. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa showed this sahabi properly how to pray. And this is what salah is. My brothers, I'm telling you I'm telling all of you here, all of you who are in front of me, you know how easy it is to be thinking of Allah from Allahu Akbar to the Salam. You're not going to believe me how easy it is. I'm going to tell you to do one thing right now. Tell you to do one thing right now. And I want you to practice this. I know it's time of between Asr and Maghrib. If it wasn't between Asr and Maghrib, I would have made you stand up right now and I would have shown you how to do the two rakats. And most of you would get more than 70%. Some of you will score 1900. Right now, I could show, I've done this in the other masajid. The thing is, you don't have to be a master of Arabic for it. You don't have to know every single word in Arabic and what you're saying to Allah. The point is, you just have to think about Allah. That's all it is. That Allah is watching me, and I'm standing in front of Allah. Allah is listening to me, and I'm speaking to Allah. That's all it needs. So for this, what I'm going to ask you to do right now, I'm going to ask you, I'm going to ask you in a little while to close your eyes. I'm going to ask you just to think about Allah, that the fact that Allah is watching. Allah is watching. That's all I want you to think. Allah is watching me. He's seeing me right now. That's all. And I don't want you to break that concentration. Don't break that concentration. And if it breaks, just open your eyes. Can you do that for me? Yes? So I'm going to take minute and a half, 2 minutes. That's all it'll take. When you're ready, get ready, I'm going to ask you to close your eyes. Just get ready, just think that Allah is watching me. That's all you have to think about. After 1, 2, 3, close your eyes. That's it. Open your eyes. That was the duration of two rakats. Most of you still had your eyes closed. Yes or no? Come, brother. Yes or no? Yes. All you need to do now is you just spend the 2 minutes, 2 full minutes. You close your eyes and Allah is watching me. Allah is watching me. Next thing you need to do is when you go home, I want you to do this. It's really easy. It's really easy. You won't believe how easy it is. Next minute, you leave your eyes slightly open, and you just think that Allah is watching me. Allah is watching me. That's the same thought. So leave it slightly open. Okay? Do that for 2 minutes. The next thing is, you get up, you just get into the qiyam position, just like that. And for 2 minutes, without saying anything, for 2 minutes, you think, not 2 minutes standing up, but for a little while standing up, Allah is watching me. Just to think that Allah is watching, with your eyes slightly open. Ruku, Allah is still watching me, Allah is watching me. Just to have that thought in the mind. Qiyam again, Allah is watching me. Just not to take the concentration away. Get into sujood, do that. Do the positions of a 2 rakat. And the last final thing is, to say Allahu Akbar, proper 2 rakats, and you've got it. Allah is watching me. All of you, almost all of you just did that. Are you able to pray 2 rakats with full concentration from takbir to salam, yes or no? Yes, you are. You just proved it. You have got it inside you. If you want to jump to the last one, straight after Maghrib, I want you to do this. Do a full 2 rakats. Allah is watching me. You don't have to know the Arabic words. If you know the Arabic words, if you know what you're saying, is better. It's good. But you don't have to. The main part of salah is أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِ. You establish prayer. Just to remember me. The remembrance of God is the main part of the devotion to Allah. And once a person has done that, you know the amount of serenity you get in your heart. You feel like you want to prolong your sujood. You feel like you want to do a ruku and do it nice and steadily. You want to stand in front of Allah and do it properly. That 2 rakats is better than 20 rakats the other way. Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah. Man United going in my head. What a goal. What a ball. What surah should I pray? Oh yeah. Inna atanaka al-kawthar wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inna atanaka al-kawthar wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inna atanaka al-kawthar wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then it's sujood and probably, I don't know, something my mates are coming down to my house. What rakat am I? First rakat, second rakat, second rakat, first rakat. Then I get up. What surah should I pray? Qul huwallahu ahad. Qul huwallahu ahad. The shortest you can find. I've prayed. I mean, doing that day in, day out, Fajr, Asr, there's no effect. Seriously, there's no effect on the heart. There's no effect on person's spirituality. You've done it. You're completed. It's done. I'm not saying your salah is not done. Please don't take the wrong impression. Your salah is done. But have you got the benefits of the salah? Has it affected your life? Has it affected your soul? Has it given you a closeness to Allah? No. But you've done it. It's like basically there's an employer and he says to in his employment, he says he's got a few employees and he says, get me this job done. One goes, comes back, and he told him, come, you buy me this and you buy me that. So one comes back with a bag of onions that have been picked properly. They're going off half, but he bought them. And yeah, he's bought a few things, he missed a few things, whatever, he's got it. The other one has taken his time, has shopped around, has bought the right item, has bought it to what the employer wants, and he would like A-class quality stuff, he's bought it. Which one would you like? You're going to like the employer who bought you? Okay, both have completed the task. There's no question about completing that. They've both completed the task. But the one who's bought it with the best of qualities, that one you have a likeliness for. Allah will love us if that kind of salah is done. And I'm not telling you, brothers, all of us are capable. Yes or no? Inshallah, from this Maghrib, there's going to be no more. And if you feel ever that you've dropped in your khushu, just do the thing I said. Sit down. Allah is watching me. Allah is watching me. Allah is watching me. 2 minutes. Get up and pray 2 rakats. And you will see at least you will have 60 to 70% of your concentration. Now, there is no Ramadan. There is no Ramadan without I'll give you a question. There is no Ramadan without salah, spirituality and so on. Or there is no Ramadan without faluda, pakora, kebab. Yeah? Gulma kebab, lamba kebab, noodle kebab. Which one? The first one. Yes? My brothers and my sisters, yes, Ramadan has got barakah. But there needs to be barakah in our spiritual lives. Yes, the kebabs and whatever are going to be there. And we don't have to have all of that. Honestly speaking, we don't have to have all of that. Let's keep moderate fasting. If I eat outside of Ramadan, I'm going to have a bowl of crunchy nut in the morning, a cup of tea, I'm at the door. Lunchtime comes, sandwich in the mouth, at the most another bag of crisp on top, water down the throat, back to work. Evening comes, few rotis, sit down, have a meal. Yes or no? A lot of people, okay? We're talking about to a large Asian community here, a few other people, alright? Please don't take offense. Right? That's how it is. My God, when we go on a spiritual retreat, we have to have, at the time of iftar, there's going to be 5 starters. Come on, when you go to a restaurant even, you have 1 starter, 2 starters, come on, 3 at the most. 5 starters! The samosas, these are given, samosas, pakoras, the kebabs, and a few types of kebabs, and some other things, that's starters. The guy hasn't started eating yet. Then he prays his maghrib, after his maghrib, he sits down to eat. And he's going to eat about 2 whole plates or whatever. How's that guy supposed to stand in Tarawih without breaking his wudu? I mean, you see him going up and down. Imam's up, finishes, the guy lets one off, sits down downstairs. Quick, do wudu and come back upstairs. And the guy complains. People complain to you, Imam, I can't keep my wudu in Ramadan. Of course you can't. You may need a bomb-blasting stomach. It's going to explode. You're not going to be able to keep your wudu. Don't blame me. Blame yourself. Take it easy. I mean, when do we do this outside Ramadan? You have so many different carbohydrates and proteins and God knows whatever. And then the drinks. Pink falooda, green falooda, yellow falooda. Yeah? Stick it all inside. It's a cocktail inside. Of course it's going to explode. So the guy, you know, he's not going to be able to keep his wudu. Okay, he does his tarawih, comes back home, then he's going to eat again. Then he eats again, goes to sleep, then he gets to suhoor, and suhoor is a 5-course meal. The guy's going to start all over again, because I might get hungry. Look, my guys, let's not joke around about this. The fact is, if I keep a Ramadan, a whole Ramadan like this, by the end of the 30 days, when the shaitan is released again, he's going to look at me, he's going to get scared. He's going to say, I've been locked up for 30 days. I'm starving. I'm saying, this guy, mashallah, has put 2 stones on. Ugly. Seriously, what are we trying to do? Ramadan is for what? Putting weight on? Ramadan is for, like, not getting hungry. The purpose is not to get not hungry all day. That's not the purpose. The purpose is that inside us, there is a beast. That beast is called the nafs. What is it called? Nafs. Nafs naturally likes to be like a spoiled kid. What is it? A spoiled kid. Now there's different children that grow up. Kids, when they grow up, they need to be trained and tamed and given discipline. Yes or no? Because if you don't give him discipline, every time the kid says, I want this, I want that, I want this, I want that, you give it every time. He wants lollipop, give him lollipop, wants to have his dinner, he'll have his dinner, he wants to have sweeties, whatever you give. Every time you give him, wants TV, you give him TV, he doesn't want to sleep on time, you don't let him sleep on time. You do that. By the time the kid's a few years old, is he going to be easy to control, difficult to control? Difficult. You know what these kids do? You see them. And they stamp their feet, they kick it. You know, kids, they do it, man. What are you going to do to them? What's the best thing to do to that kid? Don't say slap him. What's the best thing to do? No. You just ignore him. You don't need violence here, guys. Come on. You just ignore them. You don't give in to their tantrums. You discipline them by giving them alternatives. You put them slowly into a set mode. You eat this time. You make sure you can only have sweet once in a while. You can have this, play games, yes, but you've got to do your salah, you've got to do this, you've got to do your homework, you've got to go to school, and so on. Everything's got to be balanced. Yes or no? If that kid, you don't train, I'm telling you, there's some kids that grow up, and it's not like, wah, it's like, wah. Guy's 30, and you look at him, he's going, what are you looking at, boy? It's the same thing, you know, a kid hasn't been disciplined. The same thing is, you know, the nafs inside us is beast. If you don't train it, if you don't tame it, if you don't nurture it, you've got a massive problem. A serious, massive problem. Because that nafs will tell you, Fajr time you're in bed, the nafs will say, no, it's too cold outside, it's too cold. The duvet's too warm. Ten more minutes. That's a nafs. Who's that? It's a nafs. You're trying to basically do something good. The nafs tells you, nah, let me sit down. Let me see what's on TV. Oh, yeah. Let me. Can you hear it? It's your nafs. It's your nafs. You gotta train it. Salah time comes, I'll delay. This delaying, procrastinating, wanting whatever it wants, seeing some dishes, eating too much, man. I mean, doing that, right? Being lazy, having like, you see someone's got a nice car. Oh, I should have had that car. Jealousy. It's nafs. Pride, kibber, arrogance. It's a nafs. Now that nafs needs to be tamed. And the way to tame it is what? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said once to a young group of sahabas, he said, Ya ma'ashar al-shabab. Oh, young men, young teenagers or young men in their young adulthood. Man istata'a minkum al-ba'a falyatazawwaj. Whichever one of you can get married, let him get married. And if you cannot, later on he said, if you cannot get married, then he should fast. Because fasting will become a shield for him. What did the Prophet say? Fasting is a shield for him. Because what happens, my friend, is the way to train that nafs and to make sure that it doesn't become a spoiled brat inside me is to make your stomach go hungry. This is from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's own remedy. If you want to stop your shahwa, if you want to stop your lustful desires from overtaking you, if you want to stop all these evils inside you, one of the ways to stop it, of course there are many other ways in the Sharia, one of the ways to control the nafs is to fast. So he said, فَإِنَّ لَهُ وِجَاءَ. It's going to be a shield, protecting shield for you. Now you tell me, brothers, when Ramadan comes, I eat moderately. During the last hours of fasting, I become hungry. Now, you're hungry. You're not going to want to sin. When you're hungry, your stomach's saying, give me food. That's what your stomach's saying. That nafs is saying, give me food. You say, oh, hang on a minute, not now. Hang on a minute, not now. Stop crying. Not now. Stay quiet. Now, sometimes you might even get angry. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us, he said, if you're in fasting, somebody argues with you, and they continue arguing with you, he said, there's no argument. Then he said, if somebody argues, continues, just say, I'm fasting. And what is fasting about? Fasting is controlling that spoiled brat. He says, I'm hungry, I'm angry. That's what he says to you. No, you can't. You can't get angry with your wife. Just because you're hungry, you can't get angry with your family, with your friends, with people passing by, whatever. That's fasting. Fasting is not just fasting from food and drink. Fasting is fasting of what? Of these desires. The nafs says, look when you shouldn't look. There's a beautiful person walking by. Look when you shouldn't look. Fasting is fasting with the eyes. No, I'm not going to look. Fasting is fasting with the ears. To sit down there to gossip, to listen to some other person's bad nature, some riba, having some backbiting. The nafs loves it. This spoiled kid loves it. Allah made it haram. Fasting is about controlling the ears, controlling the tongue. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ Whoever doesn't leave the false statements from the tongue, the things Allah has prohibited for the tongue to say, whoever doesn't leave that, فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ For this person to leave his food and drink all day, Allah has no need for this. Allah sees no need. Because you fasted all day, that's fine, but you didn't get the benefit of fasting. The benefit of fasting is, by the end of the day, I am a much more controlled individual. Now guys, you know who's the warrior? Is the warrior the one like, someone gives him a dirty look, or someone basically challenges him? Right? Scenario A. Scenario is that I go up there and I start fighting, punching, wrestling. And scenario two is, I just put my head down, I control my anger, and I walk off. Which one's better? Come on guys, on the streets when you watch it, which one's better? On the one. Well, that means the nafs is there, right? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has pointed to number two. He has said, لَيْسَ الشَّدِيدُ بِالسُّرَعَةِ إِنَّمَا الشَّدِيدُ الَّذِي يَمْلِكُ نَفْسَهُ عِنْدَ الْغَضَبِ He said, the one who can throw his adversary onto the ground or overpower him is not the true wrestler. The real wrestler is the one who can control his desires, control his nafs, control his ego when he becomes angry. When you can suppress your anger and become, that's a man. That is a man. And that is what fasting teaches us, to be in control. And not only that, my brothers, while I'm controlling myself, okay, fine, I've stayed away from all these bad things. The doctor will give you two things. You go to the doctor, you say, doctor, I'm ill. The doctor will say two things. He's going to say to you, stay away from these foods. Stay away from these, you know, your diet has to change slightly. Stay away from these foods that you're taking in. Number one. And number two is, you must increase the intaking of these other foods, or these proteins, these calories, these vitamins. These pills I'm going to give you, you must take them with you staying away from other things. Yes or no, guys? Yes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us two things. Not one. Ramadan prescription. We're all ill. Guys, we're all ill. Don't say, I don't need to, you know, I'm not ill. No, we're all ill one because we all got problems inside us. We're not like the prophets and we have to try our best to become the best Muslims. So we're all ill in some way, like, you know, we missed this, we're supposed to do that and so on. And if somebody thinks that they've made it here, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that when it comes to the religious issues, a person should look at people above them and not people below them. People above them and not people below them. Like for example, if I'm praying my tahajjud, if I'm always controlling my anger, if I'm always basically a good person, if I've got good dealing, if I'm doing my first salah, what I need to look at is a person who's doing more than me. If I start saying, that guy doesn't pray, I pray. MashaAllah, that's your decline. That's when shaitan's got you. And when it comes to the worldly affairs, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, look at people below you, not above you. You got a 2,000 pound car, a guy's got 10,000 pound car, you say, Alhamdulillah, Allah's given me 2,000 pound car, the guy next to me doesn't even have a car. You have to look below you. A guy, you've got 3-bedroom house, somebody else got 4-bedroom house, you say, Alhamdulillah, at least I'm not in a flat. Alhamdulillah, I'm not in a flat. You always look below you, that's when you do shukr of Allah. You feel good about yourself. If you carry on looking at the people above you in the worldly matters, then you're never going to be satisfied. I'm going to get more, I'm going to get a better car, better mobile, better walk, better this, better girl, better... This never ends. The best place, I tell you, my brothers, if you want to fulfill, you want to look for the best, yeah, it's Jannah, okay? That's where Allah said you get everything. In this world, you cannot have everything. So don't try it. And this world, Rasulullah said to look at people above us. So going back to my point, two prescriptions, two things the doctor will say to you, two things Allah has said to us in Ramadan. Number one is stay away from food, drink, and your desires. Okay? He has said stay from those. So a man will not fulfill his desires during the daytime and so on. Allah says stay away from these things. But then number two is, Allah has said you increase, through the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's shown us to increase our ibadah, increase our tilawah, increase our dhikr of Allah, increase our remembrance of Allah, increase our connection with God. That's the second part. If a guy goes to the doctor and says, doctor, return back to him after 6 weeks. Doctor says, how are you feeling? He says, I'm feeling bad. Feeling the same hours after 6 weeks. He says, what did you do? He says, well, I didn't have cholesterol. You know, I had olive oil. I didn't have the vegetable oil, the Medina one. Cheap one. I bought the expensive one. I had that. I avoided this food. And he said, fine, that's good. Did you take the pills I gave you? I took a few on and off. So, guys, what did you, you're supposed to avoid this and take this. It goes in a package. Ramadan is about two things, my brothers and sisters. Ramadan is two things. Number one is, yes, we're going to avoid food. We're going to avoid drink. But the day has to be full with the remembrance of Allah. I have to increase that. Outside Ramadan, I will recite my Quran every day. Inside Ramadan, I will increase that. Increase my nawafil. Increase my salah. Increase my devotion to Allah. Increase my salawat and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Increase my Islamic spiritual side. Increase it. That is what Ramadan does. When a person does this for 30 days, a person does this in and out, fast, thinks about Allah. You're walking, my brother. You're walking. Say subhanallah. My brother, say subhanallah. Let's not be stingy on ourselves. Say subhanallah. That's it. You got one tree in Jannah. This is from Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You got one tree in Jannah, in your plot, your empty plot. Now you know how big that tree is. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that if the fastest horseman on the fastest horse was to cross the width of that tree, it would take him 500 years. Go on, say it. That's your second tree. In Ramadan, every subhanallah you say, you've got 70 trees at one go. 24 hours time, guys. Subhanallah, like a 70. Outside Ramadan, you say Alif, Lam, Meem. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said Alif is 10 reward. Lam is 10. Meem is 10. Inside Ramadan, how much is that worth? Come on, guys. 70 times 30, what's that? 2,100. Just say Alif Lam Mim inside Ramadan 2,100 compared to 30. Would you say ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ outside Ramadan? That's about 120, I don't know, 150 rewards, okay? Inside Ramadan times 70. Tell me, brothers, sitting here, okay, put your hands up to this question. How many of you in the next coming year are going to finish 70 Qur'ans? Put your hands up. Yeah, I thought so. I can't put my hand up. You know why I asked you that question? Because one Qur'an in Ramadan is equivalent to 70 Qur'ans outside Ramadan. Do you hear that? One Qur'an in Ramadan is equivalent to 70 Qur'ans that year for the whole year. La ilaha illallah. If I do this every single year in Ramadan, I've got 70 and 70 Qur'ans and 70 Qur'ans and 70 Qur'ans for all the years of my life. You know how many that is going to be? If you haven't got the tawfiq to do that, you share it with somebody. Share it with your wife. Share it with a family member. Finish the Qur'an. Take half each of the reward. There's no time to lose in Ramadan, my brothers. When iftar time comes, instead of standing around and sniffing what's on the menu, yeah, I'm going to look and that's my first shot, second shot, yeah, third one. I'm going to take three samosas in one go. Yeah. Instead of doing that, the last minutes of the day are the time when every dua is accepted. Allah is waiting. You know what Allah has said in a hadith Qudsi of Bukhari? Allah said, for every other act my servant has done, there's a reward. There's a reward, like for example, you've done tilawa, there's a reward for this, for that, there's a reward. But you know what the reward for fasting is? You know what you're going to get in the next life for fasting? Anyone answer that question? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, As-sawmu li wa ana adzi bi. Allah says, fasting was done purely for me, and I am the reward for my servant. Allah says, I'm His reward. I am His reward. You know, when you think about it, what Allah is doing, you're there all day with your iman, with the faith. From the ghaib, I haven't eaten all day. Allah told me not to eat. I knew Allah is watching me. I was all alone in the kitchen. Food was there in the fridge and on the table. I didn't touch it. That's iman. That's your certificate of iman. That is your certificate. If you ever feel, am I a good believer? Am I really a believer? You know the fact that you're going to spend a lonely time on your own. Food is just there. No one watching you and you don't eat. What's that? That's your guaranteed certificate that you're a mu'min, you're a believer. You are a mu'min, you're a believer. Give yourself a pat on the back. And when you get to that time of iftar, that Lord is so close to Allah. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ When my servant will ask of me, I am so close to him. Allah is so close at the time of iftar. Allah is watching us. You know what the whole point of fasting is for Allah is that my servant is showing me that he is a servant. Allah said, don't eat, he never ate. Allah boasts to the angels. He boasts to the angels. He said, look at my servants. I told them not to eat, they eat. And when soon as the Maghrib time comes, I said eat, the servant eats straight away. That's my servant. He hasn't seen me. He hasn't seen me. But he believes me. That's the whole point of fasting. And then, to stand in the Taraweeh, to stand calmly in Taraweeh, to come home, to sleep if you're going to sleep, if not, the nights are short, you might want to stay awake, but to have the suhoor. And at suhoor time to pray tahajjud, to pray 8 rakats, 12 rakats, whatever you can, in twos and twos, nicely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then to make dua again. That's the best time, second best time that you can make dua. All your duas are accepted. You know, the time of suhoor, please don't waste this. Don't waste this. You know, you're wasting time just, you know, waiting for the clock to come Fajr. No, that's the best time. When Fajr comes in, you know what the best action is? It's reading the Qur'an. Because Allah has said in the Holy Qur'an, إِنَّ قُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ كَانَ مَشْهُودًا. Your Qur'an recitation at the time of Fajr, angels will be surrounding you. In fact, one Sahabi came to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and he said, once a messenger of Allah, my horse was, you know, lifting its forelegs in the air at Fajr time. Rasulullah Sallallahu, and he said, I saw this light all around. He said, that was the presence of the angels. The angels will come in the multitude around me. Then I pray my Fajr with Jama'ah in the masjid. And then I will go to sleep, whatever I have to do. But when I'm going to work, brothers, don't waste your time. Going to work, I'm going to try and listen to something on the way, or at least do some dhikr or something on the way. While I'm at work, I can say, in with my tongue, without anyone watching me, La ilaha illallah. Brothers, close your mouths. Close your mouths. And say La ilaha illallah in your mouths. You have to move your tongue, have to move your lips. You have to move your lips. No, Allah made it that easy for us. Say La ilaha illallah, no one needs to see you. When you come back from work, if you're going to get a good rest, get a rest, but get up again, do some tilawah, some dhikr, something before the time of iftar. And for Allah's sake, that TV in our house, or the satellite, or the laptop, or whatever TV card you got in there, or your mobile phones in there, TV, whatever it is, cut that out for a month. Let's increase the spirituality for this month. At least for this month. Then after a whole month, a person will be so strong that the shaitan will not have any influence over them. That's when a person is a muttaqi. Now you're a muttaqi. Allah said what? يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ So that you may show have taqwa, this is why I gave you fasting. I hope inshallah, bi-idhnillah, that these few words are a good reminder for myself to practice and to have a full 30 days of Ramadan with the best of actions. And I pray that inshallah bi-idhnillah for all of us the same as well. جزاكم الله خير وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. Short dua. Have you got time? Or do you want to do that? صلى الله على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم اللهم يا حنان يا منان يا بديع السماوات والأرض يا ذا الجلال والإكرام يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث برحمتك نستغيث اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى. Allah, Mawla, we have sinned, we have come to you with our sins. Mawla, take away our sins, Mawla, give us good actions in our lives. Allah, Ramadan is here, Mawla, we ask you that you give us the best of action in Ramadan. Make us muttaqis, make us people of taqwa by the end of Ramadan. Allah, give us your forgiveness, give us your mercy. Allah, let us find Laylatul Qadr in this Ramadan. Allah, let us worship to the till our hearts are filled with your praise and worship, Mawla, till we find our devotion in your worship. Oh Allah, let not one of us go wasting Ramadan. Oh Allah, we ask you to give us tawfiq to practice upon whatever has been said. Wa sallallahu ta'ala ala khayri khalqihi Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin.